Ja, herzlich willkommen zum letzten Vortrag für heute, für dieses Meetup. Hallo Olli, schön dich zu sehen.
Servus.
Olli ist, genau, Olli ist heute der dritte Speaker hier in der Runde und hat ein ganz, ganz spannendes Thema mitgebracht, denn wie wir gerade gehört haben, ist Flow-Daten erzeugen ziemlich einfach. Die Kür ist allerdings, die Flow-Daten dann irgendwie auch zu sammeln und vor allem auch irgendwie sinnvoll auszuwerten und weiterzuverarbeiten. Olli war früher bei Google, dann bei der Exaring, jetzt inzwischen bei der SAP und wird uns heute zum Thema Flowhouse was erzählen. The stage is yours, Olli.
Danke, danke. I switch to English here, because this video is going recorded and will be published, and maybe it's of use to non-German speakers as well. I'm going to talk about Flowhouse, next generation flow analysis tooling that I wrote a couple of months ago. Who am I? Theo just introduced me. My name is Oliver, also known as Takt. I'm a senior software engineer working in SAP SE, and I'm speaking here for myself. I'm a friend of robustness and reliability and velocity, especially in software development. I'm a network automation enthusiast and a Golang and gRPC fanboy. So the agenda, first of all, who am I? We did that already. Second, we will talk about what is Flowhouse actually. I will give a brief introduction into flow and packet sampling. Talk about limits of other solutions that exist out there that only make use of S-Flow and IP fixed data in an isolated manner. I will show you how Flowhouse overcomes these limitations and how it utilizes ClickHouse database to actually make all that possible. And in the end, we'll have a live demo, and of course, there will be the question and answer section. So what is Flowhouse? Flowhouse is an S-Flow and IP fixed flow data collector and analyzer. So it combines S-Flow and IP fixed protocol with the ClickHouse database. It's written in Golang, and it also makes use of BIO, Routing Daemon, another project that I'm working on. So let's have a brief introduction to flow and packet sampling, so actually know what we're talking about here. So there's one thing, it's called S-Flow, that's basically used on switches. And I always thought it stands for switch flow, but actually it stands for sampled flow. And the idea is that routers or switches or other network elements sample one out of n packets and send that to the monitoring station. And multiple sampled packets are being encapsulated into one S-Flow packet, and the first 72 bytes of each of the sampled packets is contained in the S-Flow packet. And that packet is being mirrored basically to monitoring station. There can be some additional information attached to the raw packet header, that is the ingress and egress ports and VLANs, for example, but also if it is a layer three device, the device could attach also the Usenet hop. S4 packets are sent via UDP to port 6343. Here we have an example packet that came from a device of this IP address here. I hope you can see my mouse pointer. And then we can see that in the packet, there's multiple flow samples. And in each of the flow samples, we can actually see an input interface, an output interface, and the raw packet header of the original packet that created this S-Flow record here, basically. On the other hand, there's IP fixed. IP fixed stands for IP flow information export, and it's actually the successor of NetFlow version 9. The idea is a bit different here to S-Flow. Routers and switches sample one out of n flows, not out of n packets. And that means this requires usually having a state table. So it is limited in the amount of flows you can actually monitor with this. Multiple sample flows are encapsulated into one IP fixed packet, kind of same thing as in S-Flow, but a big difference is packets are templated here. So there's no static layout of the packet, let's say, where certain fields are filled in, but actually there's templates that are being sent by the router or by the switch. And then there's the packets with the payload that actually are formed by these templates. And what is actually in the IP fixed packets heavily depends on the vendor. So there is implementations for Linux of this, for example, where certain information are missing, while other platforms like Junos are providing certain information. It always really depends on the vendor. And what's very important here is that raw packet headers are not available with IPFix in general. And they're also sent via UDP. But aren't there plenty of options to store S-Flow and IPFIX information already? Yes, but making use of flow data is actually hard, because what you see, what you get is a 5-tuple of the network traffic that's going through the network. And 5-tuples like this one printed here are hard to reason about. So if you know that certain IP address on the left-hand side on port, whatever, talks to some other IP address on another port, talking TCP or UDP or whatever, you have probably no clue what device is talking to what device, which customer it is, and whatnot. It's even harder when you start looking at interfaces, because the interfaces are reported as numbers here and not as as interface names. So what you actually want to know when you look at your flow data, you have to want to have answers to certain questions, like which customer is consuming all the bandwidth to a POP, who is the DDoS target actually, when you want to get to know which IP address you want to black hole via RTBH, for example, or who is then of servicing me if that source address is not being spoofed, or how does certain traffic enter or leave your network? What traffic is actually going to my transit, so I can look into that data and find out who I should peer with? Maybe they are open for peering and I just don't know that traffic to certain providers going via my transit. Or what data center does traffic come from and which data center is it going to? What interface names are actually there where the traffic is going? So that these are questions that you actually have, and S-Flow and IPFIX alone are not really able to give you answers to these questions. So here are some limitations of S-Flow and IPFIX data. So there's limitations on the interfaces. As said, they are reported as interface IDs, and these are usually the SNMP interface IDs, and they are potentially unstable. What does that mean? It might be that right now interface ID 5 is a certain interface, and after rebooting the box, the ID is not 5 anymore, but 6. And suddenly, all the numbers just don't make any sense anymore. And who knows what ingress interface 111 or output interface 222 means? Nobody knows that. Or let's look at prefixes. There's no such thing in S-Flow. The prefix used to route a packet is not reported in S-Flow in general. I've never seen that. And it's sometimes even missing in IPFIX implementations, as just mentioned. IPTNetFlow is an IPFIX implementation for Linux, and it does not provide prefix information. So we don't know which prefix was used to carry traffic to a certain IP address. Or we look at ASNs. There's no such thing in S-Flow as an autonomous system number. And even in some IPFIX implementations like IPTNetFlow, ASNs are completely missing. We have no idea which ASN belongs to a certain IP address. Also, there's other restrictions that actually even the best IPFIX implementation cannot really know, and that is topological information. So who knows where a certain interface like XE000 is connected to, which remote site, which region is it going to, which carrier is used for transport services and things, all those things. Also, business information. Who knows which customer is connected to a certain interface, or which customer belongs to a certain IP, all these things. You have to bring all these data together to actually make sense of your flow data. So I invented FlowHouse to overcome these limitations. And the idea is actually that FlowHouse receives the packets, decodes them as every regular S-Flow and IPFIX receiver does, but then it enriches the flows with additional metadata. So on receiving the data, IP information is attached to the flow via BioRD, Routing Information Service. And then this information is added and also stored in the database. So all this data then goes into the ClickHouse database. I will show you later what is so special about ClickHouse and why I choose it as a solution here. Then also FlowHouse provides an HTML JavaScript front end via HTTP that allows querying the data. And when a query is executed, ClickHouse can add metadata to a query. Especially it's useful for topological information and also for business information. So you can actually form queries like saying, show me all flows of a certain customer, or show me all flows that are going via some internet exchange port and stuff like that. So here we have a picture a diagram showing how FlowHouse is actually working. So direct the great rectangular area in the middle that you see is the Flowhouse process. So it's a monolith, it's a one Golang binary that does all the work basically. So deploying it is very, very simple. On the very left-hand side, the roundish thing there is a router with S-Flow enabled or could be IPFix as well. And that one has a BMP session running to the route information server. It's a BioRD open source program as well. And that offers other services to actually receive routing tables and get a mirrored version of the routing table of the router being monitored here. Then the router pushes S-Flow data, so sends UDP datagrams to Flowhouse. And Flowhouse also uses SNMP to pull certain information from the router, but that's only used for interface mapping. Because as said, interface names are not in IPFix or S-Flow packets, but SNMP IDs are being transmitted there. So we have to have some way to look up that information. That's done by the interface mapper. So when a flow is received here, what actually happens is there's a call happening to the interface mapper to find out what is the input interface, what's the output interface. Then the stuff goes to the IP annotation layer that performs route lookups here and adds certain information. Then it goes into another module, ClickHouse Gateway, that then stores the data in the ClickHouse database. And when then a user comes and asks for certain data, they connect to the front end, execute a certain query, goes via the ClickHouse Gateway, fetches the data. The data is being transmitted back to the front end, and the JavaScript code will then print a graph, basically. So let's talk about the components a bit more in detail. So we just mentioned the interface mapper, and basically it gets this OID, aka if name, via SNMP. Why SNMP? Actually, I'm not a friend of SNMP at all, and I would not use it for anything else than this thing here. But this is the most generic way to find out an interface name from SNMP interface ID. And that just works with every device. The interface mapper periodically pulls the data, the interface names from the device. And as mentioned, input output interface names are resolved right after decoding the packets. It's the very first thing that happens. And the SNMP interface IDs are then discarded at that point. They are not being stored in the database because they are unstable anyways. Because what now has been interface ID 5 could be something completely different a moment later. So we resolve this and then save the interface name that's actually has been used here. Then there's the IP annotator, as mentioned, and that is a somewhat bigger software component, actually, that connects to the BioRD RIS via gRPC and subscribes for routing updates. So whenever a router changes routing information, it streams it via BMP to the RIS, and as soon as something changes on the RIS, this change is being propagated to the IP annotator here. So the IP annotator keeps a copy of all the BGP routes the router has, and it's even VRF aware. So if we know a certain flow belongs to a certain VRF, we can make the route lookup against that particular VRF to find out which prefix is actually carrying the traffic. The IP annotator performs the longest prefix match in LPM against the origin router's mirrored routing table and sets the source and destination prefix and source destination and next stop ASNs. And all this happens via an efficient data structure called a try. So it's basically a binary tree where a node has two childs, and basically you can imagine it to be a try where on each level one bit of the IP address is being stored, actually, and then it traverses through the whole tree to find the most specific prefix for an IP address. So that is done. Data goes into ClickHouse. What is actually ClickHouse? ClickHouse is an open source online analytical processing database management system. It is a column-oriented database. So unlike MySQL, MariaDB, Postgres, etc., it is not row-oriented, but column-oriented. I will show you in a moment what that actually means. But being column-oriented makes it blazingly fast and basically scaling linearly. And a very cool feature here is that it supports time to live on data records. So we can define that data is actually being stored for, let's say, up to 7 days, and then the old data will just fall over behind the database and is gone. That's just included. We don't need to have any programming logic in our program to make sure we get rid of the old data. Short excursus on block storage. We need this to understand why column storage is important here. Files are usually always being stored as blocks when you use a file system or a block device or something. And blocks are the only way to read and write data from storage. I've heard actually that's not true anymore with NVMe storage. I heard somewhere that byte level access should be possible there, but I'm not aware of that. And as we always usually use some file system on NVMe's, we still have block access. And the block size is typically 512 bytes or larger. For an X4 file system, the default block size is 4 kilobytes. So when we want to read just one byte, we actually have to read 4096 bytes. And that makes it important how we organize the data on the disk. So let's talk about row versus column orientation. On the left-hand side, we have the classic row orientation. That's the thing that MySQL and MariaDB and all those databases, regular purpose databases, do. They store the whole table usually in one file, more or less. One row is stored after another, and this is preferred when all or most columns of a row are usually needed together. So if you are interested in a whole record here, you want to know the ID, the first name, the surname, and the job title, it makes sense to store the data like this because you would start reading at this position and then you would read 4096 bytes. But if you are only interested in the first names, with this layout here, it would not be possible to just read John, Bob, and Alice because you have to read 4096 bytes in a row. So in the end, reading John, Bob, and Alice and maybe 1,000 other names out of this would mean you read the whole damn table. And there's a lot of information that you're actually not interested in that you have to scratch from the disk. So here comes column orientation. Column orientation, on the other hand, make sure that every column of a table is stored in a separate file. And each file contains a series of all values stored in that particular column. And this is to be preferred when only selected columns are needed. So in this case, it means we would not have one file with row orientation, but we would actually have four different files where only the one column is stored. And so the first value here is the ID 0, that is the ID of the first record in the database, and then the 1, and then the 2. And then come all the first names, John, Bob, and Alice. And then come here in another file, all the last names. And from the order, we can derive or see what the relation between the data is. So the first entry here belongs to the first entry here, and the second entry here belongs to the second entry here, of course. But this makes it way simpler to maybe analyze which first names we have in the database, because we only have to read this file from the disk now. We would do one read of 4096 bytes. We do one seek, one read, and we are done. We have all the data in memory. We can iterate over it, maybe count which names exist how often in the database. So for online analytical workloads, this is just way, way faster than the row orientation. Another interesting thing about ClickHouse is that it supports external dictionaries. So we can have external metadata in the form of dictionaries. And these dictionaries are actually mapping from a key to value. So they are hash maps. They are configured statically in the configuration of the ClickHouse database server. And we can define there that certain CSV files are to be read in. It's also possible to connect other database systems there, but I haven't tested that. Values in queries can then be replaced by values from the dictionaries. So for example, we could use that to store annotations for an IP address. So we could have a mapping saying this IP address belongs to a certain device in a certain site, in a certain region, having a certain role and all these things. And suddenly we can have queries in the database system where we query for a certain site or region or role and not just the IP address. Because out of the IP address, we cannot make any sense, but out of all this metadata, we can make meaningful queries, right? And FlowHouse actually utilizes these dictionaries to make sure we have all the metadata or can have metadata actually. Here comes an example, a sample example of the IP metadata. On the left-hand side, we see the key column. It's just a single column here, and we associated a certain IP address here with a machine name, with a role and a site and a region. And this makes it possible for us to, let's say, we have flow data. We want to break down the information by role. We could then see that certain machines of certain roles are having a certain amount of traffic. If we would not have this included in the system, we would have to find out, let's say we want to know how much traffic all the VOD servers are doing. We would have to find out all the IP addresses of all the VOD nodes and perform a query that says if source address is this or this or this or this, and let's say we have 200 VOD servers, that means it would be a very huge query finding out how much traffic they are doing. And having this metadata here in the table actually makes it possible to just ask, okay, show me all the flows where the source IP address has the role VOD, for example. Another interesting thing that can be done here is attaching metadata to interfaces. So here we have a two-column key where we match a machine name and an interface name to the metadata associated with it. So we can see here that we have some server where Ethernet 0 is connected to a device called Tor01 to a certain port, and that neighbor device has a role, and it has a site and a region. And then we can form queries asking, show us all the flows going over links that have certain roles, for example. So I guess it's time to see this in action. I have access to an installation here that is actually live on a certain video platform that I cannot mention here, or at least I didn't ask if it's okay, so I will not mention the name here. But I will show you an example. Let's say we have traffic coming from a certain POP and it's leaving in another POP, and we want to know who is sending this traffic. So first of all, let's say we are interested in all our routers in a certain site, DUX01, and we want to see all the traffic actually coming from Frankfurt. And then we can say, okay, on the input interface, there is a metadata called site. And then we'd say it comes from FRA01. And we want to break this down by the, let's say, we want to see the source IP role, run the query. And then we see that we have VOD and edge traffic coming from Frankfurt into Düsseldorf. As I said, if we would have not wanted to know this without the system, we would have to know all the IP addresses of all the systems, or actually I would have to do this, basically run that, see all the source IP addresses that I cannot make any sense of, aggregated stuff, and find out that they are actually belonging to a certain role and aggregate it all myself, or I can just use the system to see where traffic is actually coming from or from what role. So back to the presentation. It's time to come to an end. The software can be found on github.com/wireroutings/flowhouse. Pull requests are, of course, welcome. There's a few things to do. There's definitely a lack of documentation. NetFlow version 9 support should be added if someone needs it. Personally, I don't need it anymore, so I didn't port NetFlow v9 yet. It can easily be derived from the IPFIX code. So if someone wants to add this, I'm happy to merge, of course. And I would like to see a gRPC interface for querying the system in an automatic manner for automatic traffic engineering and such things. Thank you.
Seems like I'm doing the Q&A now. Thank you, Oliver. I think we have...
okay, now hier bin ich. Momo, es tut mir leid, aber es war schön, kurz zu sehen. Oliver, vielen, vielen Dank für die spannende Präsentation. Ich hoffe, es ist okay, wenn wir auf Deutsch weitermachen, nachdem das ganze Meetup auf Deutsch ist. Wir haben ein paar Fragen aus dem Publikum und die erste, die wir gekriegt haben, ist, ob du irgendeinen S-Flow-Daemon empfehlen kannst für Linux-Router.
um S-Flow zu erzeugen mit Linux? Bisher leider nein. Ich kenne nur einen, ich habe einen gesehen, der im User Space läuft und quasi TCP-Dump macht auf dem Socket Layer. Stelle ich mir nicht sonderlich performant vor, habe ich mir nicht näher angeguckt dann. Ich hätte gerne was im Kernel, aber ich kenne da noch nichts.
Sehr cool, danke schön. Die nächste Frage, die wir haben, ist, wird es da noch eine schönere UI zu geben? Weil ich glaube, das ist das, was viele wollen, ist, sie wollen schöne Graphen sehen und...
Das kann man sicherlich machen. Ich bin allerdings nicht so der JavaScript, nicht so heiß darauf, JavaScript-Entwicklung zu machen und mir da Libraries anzugucken. Und das, was da gerade ist, erfüllt meine Ansprüche. Aber wenn da jemand einen Pull-Request baut, der ein paar schönere Varianten hinzufügt oder das meinetwegen auch ersetzt, bin ich gern bereit, das zu mergen.
Sehr cool. Flowers klingt nach einer super spannenden Lösung für ganz, ganz viele, ja wahrscheinlich kleinere und mittlere ISPs, die derzeit noch nicht so viel Insights in ihre Daten haben. Hast du eine Roadmap für die 100 oder langfristiger, was wir noch an viel erwarten können?
Eigentlich nicht, weil ich gerade nicht sehe, welche Features ich jetzt noch bräuchte. Also man kann beliebige Spalten hinzufügen für Metadaten. Also wenn es zu irgendwelchen Interfaces welche Metadaten gibt, die man haben will, das ist konfigurierbar. Da muss man keine Features für implementieren. Ich sehe das so ein bisschen als fertig an. Bin auch kurz davor, da einen Versionstag 1.0 dran zu klemmen. Aber wenn jemand noch interessante Anforderungen hätte, können wir gerne hinzufügen. Vielleicht wäre es noch interessant, andere Protokolle zu unterstützen, um Flow-Daten einzusammeln. Da gab es, glaube ich, von Juniper was Neues, was quasi IPFIX-ähnlich war, wo aber die rohen Paketheader doch mitgeliefert werden. Das wäre noch eine Kombination, was man gerne einbauen könnte, ja.
Super, der erste Feature-Request kam gerade just in time, nämlich es wünscht sich jemand auf der Community, dass man zum Beispiel GeoIP-Datenbanken noch einbauen könnte und die Daten so anzureichern.
Das wäre eine Maßnahme. Müssen wir mal gucken, wie wird man das vielleicht direkt mit den Dictionaries von ClickHouse direkt erledigen kann.
Cool. Ich nehme an, Tag, du bist noch ein paar Minuten im Chat. Für alle, die noch weitere Fragen haben, du bist auf Twitter, auf GitHub anzusprechen. Wer Lust hat, mehr zu erfahren, gerne direkt Kontakt aufnehmen. Und vielen, vielen Dank für die spannende Präsentation. Und wir werden verfolgen, wie es mit dem Projekt